So we're going to discuss the Gini index and its the Lorenz curve and the role of the Lorenz curve in the Gini index. And so what we need to first do is talk about these different what we call quintiles, right? They use the word quintile down here, right? They have the word quintile. So it basically means we've broken income distribution into five equal parts. So let's say we lined everybody up. Let's say we had 100 people, and we lined all those 100 people up based on their income. So on the far left, you have the person who made the least amount of money, and on the far right, you have the person who made the most, and we have 100 of them in order based on their income. The first 20% is this lowest 20%. The next 20 people are the second 20, and then the next 20 are that middle 20%. And the next 20 people, so, you know, basically 61 through 80 would be the fourth, and then 81 through 100 would be the highest 20%. So we can do this for a population as well. And so this is actually done for the U.S. income. And when we do that, when we have that lowest 20%, we say, okay, well, what was their income, and what percent of the total income of the U.S. was that? And in 2004, that lowest 20% was 3.4%. So we're going to write that as a cumulative, so we're going to start to add in each of these quintiles. So this lowest 20% is just 3.4%. Now the next one says, okay, if I take that 20% and I add in the next 20%, what does that come out to be? So if I add 3.4 and 8.7, what do I get? I get 12.1%. Now, if I add the next 20% in there, that's the 14.7, to that 40% I already have. So now I'll have a total of 60% of the population. If I add that in there, what do we get? We get 26.8%. And then I add in the next 20%, so this one here, to that, what do I end up with? I have 50% of the total income, and then if I add in that last 20% of the population, their income was 50% of the total, so altogether that is 100%. But generally we don't graph plot things in percent, so we plot them in their decimal form, so I'm going to convert each of these to a decimal. 0.034, 0.121, 0.268, 0.5, and 1.0. And now I'm going to plot these on a set of coordinate axes. So this is going to be my y coordinate. So we're going to call this the y table. And on the left-hand coordinate, the x part of my table is that cumulative percent. So I start out with 0, 0. 0% of the population makes 0% of the income. Okay. Then the next one was that lowest 20% made 30.4%. of the total income. So I plot that as 0.2, 0.034, and that's this point right here. Okay, then the next group is actually 40%, so that's 0.4, 0.121. So that's this one here, and then 0.6, 0.268, so that's one right about there. And then 0.8, 0.5, so that's that point right there. And then lastly, 100% of the population made 100% of the income, and we get that one there. And so this curve that connects these, and you might say, well, great, we can easily draw that in. Sure, I can connect the dots. But it turns out it's not so easy to come up with a mathematical formula for that. And this curve is called the Lorenz curve, and it is a mathematical formula that goes through, notice it passes through each and every point here, okay? And it turns out it's not so easy to do. It's some pretty high-level math to do that, okay? But that's okay. We're going to learn in another video and in our project that we can approximate the Lorenz curve using a power regression, but for right now we're just going to talk about that. This is called the Lorenz curve. Okay, so in order to talk about the Gini index or Gini coefficient, some people call the Gini index it's a number between 0 and 1, and the Gini coefficient would be a number between 0 and 100. Right? It's a percent whether you write it in decimal form or you write it in percent form. It just really doesn't matter, right, whether you call it an index or a coefficient. It's basically representing the same thing. All right, so we have our Lorenz curve, right? That's our purple curve here. Oops, actually need to use pen there. That's the Lorenz curve, which represents the actual distribution of income based on quintiles. And then we have this other function, this other graph here, which is the line y equals x. Maybe if I use a highlighter, it'll show up a little bit better. So if I use that line y equals x, now this represents the area of perfect equality, or the line of perfect equality. This is perfect equality. That's where 20% of the population makes 20% of the income, and 40% of the population makes 40%, and 60% makes 60%, 80 makes 80, and 100 makes 100. So notice the line y equals x goes through that perfectly. And so they've highlighted here this, what's called the area of inequality. So the area of inequality grows larger when we have a less equitably distributed income, okay? So when the Lorenz curve gets larger and has more of a curve to it, notice this area of inequality gets bigger and bigger and bigger, okay? And the more close the Lorenz curve is to this area of inequality, then that number gets smaller and smaller. That's essentially the idea behind the Gini index, is we want to measure the area of this inequality and compare it to the area of perfect equality. And that's really what we're talking about. Anytime you talk about an index, you're comparing two things, like the consumer price index is the comparison of prices now to comparisons of prices sometime in the past. So a Gini index is a comparison of this area of inequality to the area of perfect equality, okay? And so that's what we're gonna delve into next time. How do we actually, or next slide, how we actually calculate this. So the next question we must answer is, how do we find that shaded area, that area of inequality? So the area of inequality can be represented with an integral, right? We studied how we can use integrals to find areas between curves. So in this case, the integral is, where is the left endpoint? The left endpoint, we go from 0 on the x-axis to 1 on the x-axis, right? We're only looking for the area between 0 and 1. Which function is the top function? That's our line, y equals x, and the bottom function is our Lorenz curve. So if we use the top function minus bottom function, so the top function is y equals x, and our bottom function is the Lorenz curve. So that area of inequality is calculated by calculating the integral from 0 to 1 of x minus the Lorenz curve, whatever that Lorenz curve might be. Okay. The next part of the computation of finding a Gini index is actually the area under the ideal, which we had mentioned that the ideal Lorenz curve, or the perfectly equal income distribution, is the line y equals x. So what area is represented by the area under this curve? Well, that would be this whole area under here, right? And what shape is that? That's just a triangle, right? So we don't need any fancy calculus to calculate the area of this triangle. All we need is one of our basic geometry formulas, right? That the area of a rectangle is 1/2 the base times the height. And so the area under this ideal curve is 1/2 the length of the base, which the base goes from 0 to 1, so that's 1, times the height. The height is also goes from 0 to 1 times 1, so that area is 1/2 square units. So we're super close to calculating the Gini index. We had mentioned earlier that the index is the comparison of the area of inequality to the area under the ideal. Okay, so we're going to put that together in the next slide. So the next question asks, what is the ratio of the shaded area to the ideal? So let's recall the shaded area, or the area of inequality, divided by, so that's what we mean by ratio, to the area under the ideal, is equal to, well, the area of inequality was 0 to 1, x minus the Lorenz curve. And the area under the ideal was just a plain old 1 half. Well, we know we don't like fractions inside a fraction, so instead of dividing by half, we're going to instead multiply by the reciprocal. And so we end up with 2 times that number, but in fact, we can go one step further if we would like, because we know how to integrate x all by itself. So if we're going to go ahead and use this, this would be 2 times the integral of x, which is 1 half x squared from 0 to 1 minus the integral from 0 to 1 of the Lorenz curve. And if we distribute the 2, 2 times a half is x squared from 0 to 1 minus 2, 0 to 1, the integral of the Lorenz curve. And when we plug in 1 and 0 into x squared, what do we end up with? 1 squared is 1, 0 squared is 0, so we end up with 1 minus 0. So this ends up being 1 minus 2 times 0 to 1 of the Lorenz curve. Okay, so this is actually what is called the Gini index, or like I said, Gini coefficient. And so we'll talk about some of the properties of this number in the next slide, but that's basically, that's your formula. That's what you're going to use. All right, some properties of the Gini index. The first one, since this is a ratio of two areas, and the bigger of the two areas is in the bottom, the Gini index is always, whoops, that's not the order I wanted those in. And it's not necessarily a function of x, right? So we just can say g. There we go. So the Gini index is between 0 and 1, or if we're, so that's a percent in decimal form, or sometimes, like I said, you'll see it as in between 100%, right? So we're talking about a ratio of, right, our area of inequality compared to, compared to the area under the ideal, right? So in both cases, we have y equals x on the top here, and then here we have the Lorenz curve, and then down here we have the x-axis, okay? So the ratio, the properties of the Gini index, right, which are area of inequality divided by 1 half, or the area of the ideal. Okay, and that area of inequality is always going to be between 0 and the full triangle, right? Depending on what the Lorenz curve is, right, there it's always going to be between 0, right? You might not have no area of inequality. If the area of inequality is 0, the Lorenz curve is exactly the ideal, then the area of inequality is 0. And then you have 0 over a half and you get 0. If the Lorenz curve is the case where, like, nobody has any money except for one person, then the area of inequality is exactly the triangle, right? So what I'm talking about here is if your Lorenz curve is very close to the ideal, then you have a very small area of inequality, and the numerator of your fraction is going to be very small. So when you have a very small fraction, then you're going to have a very small number. So this is close to 0 for the Gini index. Versus, let's say you have just, like, only a few people own a lot of money. Everybody else makes very little. And in that case, you're going to have this case, That's when the Gini index is close to 1. And most Gini indices are going to be, you know, somewhere between 0.2 and 0.6 or 7 or 8. And there's actually a Facebook, an article that came out recently about some of the different countries in the world and which ones had the most inequality in terms of income distribution. So that was an interesting read. But that's kind of the basics of the Gini index is, right, you have the formula that G equals 1 minus 2, 0 to 1, integral of the Lorenz curve. And it's always going to be between 0 and 1 if you're using it in a decimal ratio, or between 0 and 100 if you're using it as a percent ratio. And the closer that your actual Lorenz curve is to the ideal, then the closer your Gini index is going to be closer to 0. And this is good, right? This means we have an equitable distribution. And the closer we are to 1, that means the Lorenz curve is far from the ideal, and we're going to be close to 1. This is bad. This is where you have, like, most people make absolutely no money or very little money, and 1 or 2 or a very small number of people make all of the income, okay? And so that's kind of the gist of the Gini index.